All right, you should probably raise it a little bit. I propose to wait until 10 after 4. Put some time for the people who are to move to one other. Do you have any question before we start? How is the course going for you? Is it difficult? Is it difficult?
Yes.
Too difficult?
Sometimes.
Sometimes. If it were too easy, you would feel insulted. It's difficult to say. The difficulty is that there are many new ideas coming at you every time. Every lecture, there's a new set of ideas. It's a bit fast. Okay. So what is reassuring is that if it's hard for you, it's hard for everybody. Another age of it. It's interesting to see. It's a class with about 550 students now, and there's a very small subsection left for this debriefing. So it's intriguing to know who is coming to this, who is not. I suspect that students who are completely lost are not coming because they realize they will not understand anything and it's too late. Students who understand everything may want to know they understand the very last thing, so maybe they and so you know, we are probably in the top half of the class, maybe in the very top of the class, we'll see. Okay, so
the final cumulative is going to be based on the last section of the class.
The final will be comprehensive. We can go back to the first lecture all the way to the last. So it's probably the case that in probability it will cover the last part a little bit more than the other part. This is more of a personal distribution. This is your chance to ask questions. I will review the midterm slowly. I will start by reviewing the context in which the midterm was written. Then we will go to the questions. We will talk about the short answers for probability states and then about the computation of the book. There were very few ideas, even though it looks like a lot, there are very few ideas in the course. And the ideas are like this, it's the probability space. So a set, you assign non-negative number to the elements of the set, those numbers are like 2-1. Then you assign a number to the subsets, which we call events. We get an event, which is the sum of the properties of the outcomes. Let's wait a second. It's going to give us a simple number. Then it starts getting a little bit more complicated because you start talking about conditional probability. Because A given B. So that's a new idea, right? It's not trivial, but if you think about it, there's a natural way to define it, and that's the definition of criteria. Then we have seen a simple result, the law of social probability, which follows directly from the definition. And the idea there is that you partition an event into intersections with other events. From that, you can recover the probability of the event. Then Bayes' rule, which follows. And then with the definition of conditional probability, we define independence. If the probability of A given B is the probability of A, then we say that A and B are independent. So that's about it. Not too much to say. The next idea is random variable. We define X of omega to be a real number. So for a real omega, we assign, to a real omega, we assign a real number for the random variable. Then we can combine random variables. So for example, if x and y are random variables, we can define a function of x and y, which is a new random variable. So it assigns a real number to omega, and the real number that it assigns is simply g of x of omega. So by doing that, we can combine random variables. For example, we can define the sum of random variables, we can define the squares, we can define different squared or anything we want. Right? So it's a new random variable. Then we define expectation. And we said that there are two ways to compute the expected value of a random variable. You know, you take the sum of all the values, the value times greater than the value, or you sum of omega, and greater than omega times the value of the random variable to omega. And then we have seen from this definition, it's easy to show that it's linear. The mean value of a sum is the sum of the mean values. And it's fine conditional expectation given an event. It's just you replace the probability of omega by the probability given A. And then we have seen that you can write the mean value of x, the mean value of x in the net times the probability of A. And today we've seen an extension of this condition of different values of some other random variables that we can find to control. Okay. Yeah, in my review here, I do not talk about the Chebyshev check. So we saw some inequalities to the check. Do you have any questions about? It looks very simple, right? to solve problems. You say, well, yeah. I thought it was simple. I thought that was a bit thick. And then put it in a tube. All right. So then let's go over the question. These joint events or the positive quality cannot be independent, true or false. We have two events, A and B. They are disjoint, and they have a positive quality each. They cannot be independent. That's truly really false. And intuitively, if you know that one occurs, you know the other one does not. Right? So clearly, they cannot be independent because the other one is the positive quality of occurring if you do not know that the other one. So the meaning changes. Right? Cannot be, and formally, the point of intersection should be the product of the probabilities, so they're independent, but that cannot be because the point of A and B is zero, they are disjoint, and the product is positive because they both have a positive point. So that confirms the intuition that they are disjoint. You know that one happens, you have the other one. You learn something about this. So I think most of the students can also. Two, or 1B. You can find events A and B such that point of A given B is bigger than point of A, and point of B given A is less than point of B, true or false. So here it's a bit more subtle, but if the point of A given B is bigger than point of A, it means that A and B are positively correlated. When B occurs, you know that A is more likely to occur. And if you smoke, you are more likely to have cancer. So if A and B are positively correlated, this is a symmetric relationship. If A and B are positively correlated, B and A are positively correlated. So This says that they are negative economic. So that cannot be. Okay, so the point of A, given the bigger point of A, if you multiply by the point of B, hello there, there's one shared left, and you can sit on the table if you know. Sitting on the floor is not very pleasant. So there's one shared there, you can move it. Can you see anything? Yeah. Yeah, so we started with you the questions, right? We are with the second. And I said that well, if point of A given B is bigger than the point of A, the intuition is that A and B are positively correlated. For example, A, if you have cancer, B is small. Pointing that you have cancer in your smoke is bigger than the point of A in cancer. Right? Without negatives. That should be a symmetric relationship, so this should be false. Right? But to prove it formally, you just use a definition. The point of A given B bigger than the point of A, you multiply by the point of B. So point of A given B times point of B is the point of A and B. That's bigger than point of A times point of B. And then you say, you see it's symmetric. You can interchange A and B. For example, you can divide by the point of A. And then you get the point of B given A is bigger than point of B. Right? So being positively correlated is a symmetric relationship. So what do you need to know to solve this problem? To know the definition of point of B. Okay, if the point of A given B is the point of B, that A and B are independent, true or false? Well, it does not fit the definition. Right? The definition is that the point of A given B should be the point of A, not the point of B. So you suspect that this has to be false, right? It must be false. Now the question is that if we find a counterexample, right? We do not ask you to justify anything. That there should be a counterexample. And this is a counterexample. You can check that it shows that it doesn't work, that they are not independent. But intuitively it's clear. It's not the right definition of independence. It's not the, so the counterexample says, okay, I think simple point is this, with four. It may be possible to do it with three elements, I don't know. But I'm just interested in four. But omega is 1, 2, 3, 4, uniform, so each outcome is 21, 4. A is 1, 2, 3, B is 3, 4. Then you look at the point of A given B. Point of A given B, so you know that you are in B, and you ask what is pretty that I'm in A. But there's only one check out of two if you are in B, right? Has to be 3, so it's 21.5, and the point of B is also 1.5. So the point of A given B is the point of B. Right? But the point of A is 3/4, so the point of A given B is not the point of A. So they are not telling you. So once you suspect it's false, you try to play around and you try to find a good example. And I like simple examples. Right? You can make more complicated examples where you have all dice and all that, but I look always for the simplest example I can find. It's very good. So maybe I have to do that. You're very quiet. You said what? Free speech. Is it okay? Is this acceptable? So then what you need to know this? Well, you need to know the definition and it reinforces it. True or false. For a random variable x, it is always the case that e of x squared minus x squared minus 1. So there I was trying to find something cute. So if you put the minus 1 on the other side, you get x squared minus x plus 1. Right? And you know that x minus 1 squared is x squared minus 2x plus 1. So this is almost like x minus 1 squared being positive. Oh, that's what I need. So this should work, right? It's essentially the idea of the proof. Because this should be true. But the way to do it, okay, I look at x squared minus x plus 1 is bigger than x squared minus absolute value of x plus 1, because I remove 4 and I take the absolute value. And it's bigger than x squared minus 2x plus 1, right? Because absolute value of x is 1 minus 2, so I subtract even more. And that x minus 1 squared, which is non-negative. And therefore, if you take the mean value of this non-negative random value, you should get some non-negative number. And that's what we should. Just slightly tricky, but not extremely tricky, right? Is it too tricky? No. Yeah? Okay, okay, okay. If you don't touch it. So you could have said let's try chip chair for Markov, but it's not much to go on because you don't know anything about it. You don't know the value, you don't know anything. So you cannot use any chip chair for Markov in politics. So it's a bit of a problem in probability, right? Nobody tells you apply this method to calculate this and then you find the answer. If the breaker phase is bigger than breaker of the complement, then that should remain true if I know that the effect is this true. It's tempting to think, oh yeah, if it is bigger, then it remains bigger when I know something else. But if you know something else, it may shift around the likelihood of A versus the likelihood of A complement. And that's what is happening. So it must be false. And if you want example, for example, let's say that B is the complement of A. Then the quality of the complement of A given the complement of A is 1. But the quality of the complement of A given the complement of A would be 0. Because if the complement of A occurs, A cannot occur, right? So you get 0, can be not bigger than 1, right? But you show that one is good, careful, right? These inequalities are not preserved when you do the condition. Right? So what do you need to know to do this? Right? You need to have a picture of what's going on. Right? Is it too tricky or is it okay? Alright. Sure. The biased cone, I think accumulate 2x. What is the breaker? So what is omega? What is the breaker of omega? We have to describe the breaker space corresponding to say to this experiment. So if you got one, you get one. Then I flip again until I get the second time. There are a few possible answers, right? I to describe the outcomes of this experiment. The first outcome, probability space that comes to mind, is that you flip a coin forever, right? You flip it, so you have head space that goes forever. That's omega. But then the problem is, what is the probability of one particular omega? So if I look at the infinite string of heads and tails, what is the probability that the infinite string occurs? Zero. Because it's p, 1 minus p, 1 minus p, but keep on multiplying forever, you get zero. So that's not useful. You say, oh, this is omega, but all the outcomes are probability zero. You cannot compute any probability of any event, so that's not a good description. Yeah? That's not useful. So you have to think of something else. And if something else, I draw a picture, right? Try to look at the outcomes that are important for this experiment. And they stop at the second head. So you could say, well, an outcome is a string of heads and tails that ends with a head and that has another head somewhere. Right? That would be okay. Right? But a more economical way of writing such a string is to say, well, I will flip the coin A times to get the first head, and then I will flip it B times to get the second head. So everything that I need to know is contained in this A and B. if I know the number of times I do the first hat, and then the number of times I do the second hat, I've described exactly what I care about, right? So that's most communicable. It's easier than writing TTTTTH, right? When you say AB, it could be 5, 4. Or it could be 1, and then 1 again. Right, that's nice. All right, so then I have to define the quality of an omega. So this is omega, AB, what is the quality that I flip A times to get the first hat? Well, I need A minus 1 tails, followed by 1 hat. Then I need B minus 1 tails, followed by 1 hat. And this will add up to 1, right? Because if I sum this first part over A bigger than 1, it's summing over all the powers of 1 minus b, which is 1 over 1 minus b, 1 over b, that means the first part will be 1. Then if I sum this over b, I'll get 1. So those qualities are up to 1, but they should. But again, there are many other descriptions. You could say TTTH, TTTTH, and then you write down the quality of this particular string. Fair enough, right? Okay, let's think of B1234. So before we this page with four points. I know that A is 1, 2, 3, and I want an even event B that has positive quality such that A and B are independent. So here you have to think a little bit, right? Say what? When we take B to be the element, the event, there's only the outcome 1. Okay, let's try that. Right? If I take only the outcome 1, then the quality of B will be 1/4. The quality of A is 3/4. The quality of A times the quality of B will be 3/4 times the quality of 3/16. That's not the same as the quality of A and B. So that doesn't work. I can say, well, maybe I can try B to have the elements 1, 2. That doesn't work. Or maybe it's 3, 4. Nothing works. So that's a puzzle. That's a D. There's a trick here. If I could have taken B to be the empty set, and the quality of B would be 0, the quality of A intersect B would be 0, that would be the product of the quality of A and B. That would be OK. But I'm not allowed to take B to be empty. So let's try to take B to be omega. So you take B to be omega. And then the quality of omega given A, it's 1, right? If I know that I'm in A, I know that I'm in omega. And that's also the quality of omega. That's the only example I think that works. Tricky? Yeah, a little bit tricky. A little bit tricky, but it forces you to know what the quality space is, what independence is. Okay. Questions? Okay.
Is it necessary to show the probability that given A, to find probability of sample space equal 1? Can't we use it that we know if, let's say, given B, we have to find probability of A, it will be equal to the multiplication probability B on A, right?
Yes.
Can you like use this formula instead?
Yeah, I could.
And
yeah.
It will be, for example, if you know that the probability of B would equal sample space, then probability of A given B would be equal 3 or 4, right?
Yeah, so if I take the quality of omega and A.
Yeah.
Omega intersection with A. There's the quality of A. It is also the quality of A times 1, which is the quality of omega. So the quality of omega and A is the quality of omega, this 1, times the quality of A. See that? Maybe I can write it on the board. Yeah, in fact, you write it on the screen. This is the same as A. Hmm. So that works. So that's equivalent to this. You can multiply this by the point of A, which is the point of omega n A.
Can I prove that probability A given B is equal to probability A?
B being omega. B is omega in this case. I've chosen B to be omega. So the point of A given omega is the point of A. Because knowing omega is knowing, it's not very different anyway.
No, I'm saying if we flip it, we say that probability, find probability of A given B, and if you prove that it will equal probability of A, then we prove that B is greater than 0 and these both events are independent.
So B is omega.
Yes.
And I claim that this is the
probability
of
A. Yeah. Can you say this?
Yeah, please. Because knowing omega, we know that omega occurs anyway, no? Mm-hmm. So that does not change anything, so it's the point of it. Mm-hmm. So simple ideas, but you see that you have to really understand them to see exactly what. Okay, this is an example that I gave in the review of, like, you have to put this base on the guys 1, 2, 3, 4, you want to find events that are pairwise independent but not mutually independent. It's a draw picture. Omega is 4 powers, and you take 3. I think the example I gave in the lecture was this. That's a good example to have in mind because it shows the difference between pairwise independence and mutual independence. It's important to understand that it's not the same thing. Mutual independence is a bit stronger. It's quite a bit stronger. So here, the point of A, point of B, point of C, they are all 1/2 because they have 2 atoms of the 4. The point if A intersect B, well, they have 1 point in common, so it would be a quarter, which is the product of their polarities. And similarly for any other two. So they are pairwise independent. But if you take the intersection of that, right here, the point of the intersection would be a quarter, which is not 1/2 times 1/2 times 1/2. They are not independent. Right? If they were mutually independent, the point of A intersect B intersect C would be the product, like when it's 3 times. The point of the intersection, the point of one outcome, which is quite. So the example is a bit different, it's not this one, right? The example there on the board is the other scale is 1, 2, 3, 4. And I have these 3 events. A, B, 1, 2, 3.
Can I use 1, 2 for A, and then for B is 2, 3, for C is 3, 4?
1, 2, 3, 4. No, because then A and C will not be independent; they will be disjoint.
Okay.
Right. It's a bit.
How about 1, 2, 2, 3, 1, 4? 1, 3. Sorry. The last one is 1, 3.
1, 2, 2, 3, 1, 3. Okay. Okay, this is a little counting thing, right? The counting in a naive way. Now that 2 cards will have bet of 52 cards. That is the point is the value of the first card is strictly larger than that of the second. Then I'm trying to be careful about what I mean by value. But the values are 1 to 10 for the cards with a number. And then I say 11 for the jack, 12 for the king, 13 for the king. Right? So those are the 13 graphs. There are four colors. Right? Well, four suits. Like the two graphs representing the first color was only larger. And this is a bit tricky. Yeah, this I came up with this. It took me a few minutes to solve it because I tried very difficult solutions. And then I said, well, maybe if I can find the likelihood that they are the same value, then it will be easy. Because if they are not the same value, well, with respect to 50%, the first one will be bigger than the second. So if I can find the likelihood that they have the same value, I'm done. Then to find the likelihood of the same value, you have to say. I claim that, okay. The two guys in the same value is 23 out of 51. And why is that? Well, you say that the first one is an S, for example. What is the likelihood that the second one is an S? Well, there are three S's left in a deck of now 51 cards, because I removed one card. I remove one S. What is likelihood that I take a second S? Well, there are three S's out of 51. And that's true for any value that you pick, right? So it's 3 out of 51. It's 23 out of 51, they will have the same value. With 20, so there's 1 out of 17. So with 20, 16 out of 17, they do not have the same value. And then half of the time, the first one is larger. That 60 out of 7, one is larger than the other one. And the first, it will be the first one with 21 up. So therefore, you know, so it's 8 out of 7, half of 16. A bit tricky, right? If you try to eliminate all the outcomes where one is slightly larger than the second one, it's complicated. And if you start like that, it's really, you get exhausted before you find the answer. You make a mistake about the way. So the trick here is to say, well, there must be an easy way to do this. Otherwise, professor is so nice, he will not have asked the question. Skeptical. So, that's. I told you, if you embark on a complicated solution, you are probably on the wrong path. Okay. Move all the balance six-sided time twice. Notice quickly that the total number of bits is less than 10, given that it is larger than 7. This is a conditional probability again, that you're filled with a B. So, we look at the total number of bits, X. And the total number would be the sum of the numbers on the two dice, right? So therefore it will go from 2 all the way to 12. And then we have looked at the picture on the other sheet, the picture of B. There's only one way that you get 2, it's 1-1, right? One says up to 36. Now to get 3, there are two ways. It could be 1-2 or 2-3. There's 1-2 or 2-1. Two outcomes. To get 4, there are three outcomes. 1-3-2-2-3-1. So you see a pattern. 1-2-3-4-5-6. 5-4-3-2-1. Those are the numbers of outcomes. You divide by 36, you get the probabilities of the different values of x. Yeah, so that's the figures, but also. Now, we apply the point to the formula for the conditional point. The quality of A given B is the quality of A and B divided by the quality of B. The quality of A and B is the quality that X is either 8 or 9. And then the quality of B is the quality that it is 8, 9, 10, 11, or 12. And I know the quality is about those, right? So 8, so I look at 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 8 is 5. And 4 and 9 is 4. So, it's 5 plus 4 divided by 5 plus 4 plus 3 plus 6. It's 3. So, it's relatively straightforward, right? You just can't locate it. No quantum mechanics. No shooting limitations. Just looking at the two dots. Yes.
Can I ask something about like
two 2B.
Yeah. In general, if you want to prove that that three events are mutually independent, you say probability of A and F C.
Oh, then you mean 2C.
Oh, yes, sorry.
Yes.
Probability of A and B and C. So in this case, would it be like the probability of A and B and C is equal to, well, in that example, it would be equal to zero. Yeah?
That's right.
And that's different from 1A.
And therefore, it's not, we are not mutually independent. Because the product of the point P should be 1 half times 1 half times.
Yeah.
Okay. It's not zero.
Okay.
Yeah. And in this example, the point of A and B and C is the point that the outcome is 1, which is 1 chance out of 4. And the product is 1A.
Yes.
Yeah, so the solution that they are not in the next mutually independent. All right, so counting the figure. Okay, so look at this, right? We have two possible dice. One is 4 sides, the other one is 6 sides. Well, and then you get the outcome is 4. You want to know what is going to be that came from the 4 sided die. But this calls for Bezout, right? You have a symptom, you get the form, what is the cause of that? Right? So straightforward Bezout. Now, this is now so that you can draw my little diagram. That's easier again. It's a four-sided, six-sided die. Expecting 1/2, I take the four-sided. Expecting 1/2, I take the six-sided. Then I get a 4, right? Observe a 4. What is the point here that I get a 4 if it's a four-sided die? There's 1/4. What is the point here that I get a 4 if it's a six-sided? 1/6. So Bell's rule is the point here that it is the four-sided, right? So what I do is the pointy of four-sided, even if I get a 4, is the product 1/2 times 1/4 divided by the two products, 1/2 times 1/4 plus 1/2 times 1/6. So I always draw a diagram like that, so I get confused. Did you think it's clear that it's more likely to come from the four sided? Right? Mm-hmm. Since a priori they are equally likely, a posteriori the four sided should be more likely. It's not like Ebola. Going is equally likely to be fair, but such that the probability of H is 0.6. You flip the coin 10 times, you get 10 heads. What is the probability that the next coin yields heads? So this is a little answer to the gambler's fallacy. Right? When you see something happening, then you bet it will happen again. Well, it could. It could if there is a way that it could be more likely. Right? So this is. This was trying to address this gambler's fallacy. Why do people believe that if something happens often, it will happen again? Right? Right? Because maybe the coin could be biased, remember?
Sorry, can we go back to the previous example?
Yes.
I'm just wondering why you have to take into account that in a numerator, why do you have to multiply by 1/2?
Oh.
Is the probability that it's a 4-sided die and the outcome is 4? Why is that not just 1/4?
It is, but you have to take into account the prior. Because if I told you that the point is that you got a four-sided die instead of being 1/2, if I told you it's zero, Right? If I told you, you always get a six-sided die. What is another die that is four-sided? And you get a four, what is the probability that you get, that you use the four-sided die? Well, it's still zero. So the prior matters. That's what Bayes understood, right? So you have to multiply by the prior. So we say with 81 half, you have a four-sided die. With 81 half, you get a six-sided die. So that's why the likelihood that you have Ebola, given that you have a fever, is very small, because the prior is very small. So that was the lesson of Bayes. And before Bayes, people were completely lost in problems like this. They didn't know how to think about it. Now it's your own. Okay, so you roll a coin 10 times and you can get 10 pairs. So it's likely that the coin that you rolled is biased in favor of heads. It's very unlikely that the fair coin will get, it's much less likely that the fair coin will give you 10 successive heads than the biased coin. How do we figure out the probability that the coin is a biased coin? Bayes' rule, right? Bayes' rule will tell us. So how do we apply Bayes' rule? So, I draw my picture. I say there are two coins. One coin is said that the probability of head is 0.6. The other coin is said that the probability of head is 1/2. It's a fair coin. Right? And the coin is equally likely to be either of them. So these are the priors. And then I roll the coin 10 times and I get 10 H's. So what is the probability that I get 10 H's if it's 0.6? Well, it's 0.6 to the 10, right? If it is a fair coin, the probability that I get 10 H's will be 0.5 to the 10. So to find the probability that I got the biased coin, the probability of this one, the posterior probability, I applied Bayes' rule. So the probability P that I'm looking for, the probability that the coin is this one, will be 1/2 times 0.6 to the 10 divided by 1/2 times 0.6 to the 10 plus 1/2 times 0.5 to the 10. That's the Bayes' rule again. So now I know that the point is that I get one. So this is Bayes' rule. I do not ask you to calculate the value, but it's about 86%. So indeed, it's much more likely that you got the biased coin because you got 10 points. Then you calculate what is the probability that I will have that it helps again. Right? It's 0.6 times P. So if I have the biased coin, the probability that I get helps again is 0.6. Right? And if I got the other one, then it's 0.5. So this is probably that the next coin will conflict with the real heads given the previous step. You see, it's more than 50%. So that's the gambler's intuition. Right? Which makes sense if you guys are not. Okay? So this was. So far, what did we use? We have used some basic counting, the definition of conditional probability, the definition of mutual independence, and Bayes' rule. We're already quite far along in that. Three. Define random variable in a short sentence. So I stated three times in the lecture. I said you should know that random variable is not random, it's not variable. What is it? Well, it's a real valued function of the outcome of the randomness. It's interesting, when I teach 126, I tell the students, this question will be on the midterm. I will ask you to define a random variable. And then we do the midterm, and half of the students cannot find the definition. I know you are under a lot of stress here. I focus on this course, we focus on 15 other things. So I understand it. But somebody here has a problem. Wait, this is what you have. You want to do it again. You have uniform weighted space, so the two outcomes are equally likely. You have to produce a random variable that is V0 and minus 1.
Okay.
So if it has mean 0, it means that the value of the random variable where the output is 1 should be minus the value of the outcome of the value it's 2. So x of 1 should be minus x of 2, so that the mean will be 0. Now we have to find the point value, so I'd call it A and minus A. If a random variable is equally likely to be A or minus A, what is its variance?
Is it just the second moment?
Which is, in this case, if it's A or minus A, the mean value of the square of that, 1. The mean value of a random variable which is either A or minus A, what is the square of A? A squared. What is the square of minus A?
A squared.
A squared. What is the mean value? Is it A squared or A squared? A squared, right? So if a random variable is A or minus A, the variance is A squared. I want the variance to be 1. So A should be 1. X of 1 is minus 1, x of 2 is 1. Is there another option? Yes. It could be x of 1 is 1 and x of 2 is minus 1. There are two such random variables. Only two. Is this tricky? This is a little bit more difficult. I know you guys want to choose more. So you need to avoid this case. But we find two random variables x and y, so the pxy is here and it's here. Let's try to do it when, instead of if omega is 1, 2, 3, 4, let's try to do it when omega is 1, 2, 3. Let's try to answer the same question, but omega is only 1, 2, 3. We have to define two random variables, x and y, such that the mean value of the product is the product of the mean values, and they are not independent. How would I do? Well, one easy idea is to say, well, let me choose a random variable such that x times y is always 0. So the mean value of x times y will always be 0, right? 0. So now I have to find x and y such that the product of the mean value is 0. So maybe I'll try to choose random variables such that the mean value of x is 0. Then I will be done, right? So x times y is 0 and the mean value of x is 0. And I want them not to be independent. Okay? So that's what I'm doing. Okay. So each point here will give me a value of x and y. Yeah. We have to find three values. Just put three dots. So if the product is 0, x, I would like xy to be 0 always. So x is 0 or y is 0 for all the points. And I want the mean value of x to be 0. Right? This is one example. X times y is always 0, the mean value of x is 0, so this satisfies the condition. Are they independent? Well, if I know that x is, say, 1, this could be 3, doesn't matter. If I know that x is 1, then I know that y is 0. If I don't know that x is 1, then maybe y is not 0, so they cannot be independent. So the story here is similar, right? But here I did it with 4 points. Okay? Now you could say, okay, for this example, we could have said, well, instead of taking y here, maybe I could have taken y here, right? This third point. But this is not a good example. Why is that a good example? Why doesn't this work? So I have three values, right? I claim that this is not an example that satisfies this condition.
You could have four values in the background.
Well, no, but this is the linkage 1, 2, 3. It's the one, one,
two, three. That example is not independent.
They are not independent, right? Because the value of y does not depend on the value of x. It's always zero. But this is not a good example. So if you say, oh, I will choose x to be zero all the time, then clearly it will satisfy this condition. But then x and y are independent because x is always zero. Right? So a constant random variable, the value is always zero, but not. It's independent of any other random variable. So that does not work. But if you choose the random variables can be uncorrelated, we know correlation, right? We define correlation now. The correlation is E of x, y minus E of x, V of y. These are uncorrelated random variables. They are not independent.
So, does it mean this equation is, I saw this equation holds only if and only if x and y are independent.
So it's not. No. It holds if they are independent, but not only if. Right? And if you look at my review on Friday, I insisted on the fact that it's if, but not only if. So this insistence on the not only if was a clue that there would be a question on the return. Find a correct example. This is the question. This is a difficult question because you have to pick out again. Right? We roll a die twice. X is the maximum of the number of pips on the tree here. What is the mean value of X? This is a mess, right? This is a difficult question. And you look at the maximum, it can be 1 respecting 1 up to 6. Because the maximum is 1 only if they are both 1. Right? The maximum can be 2. If the outcome is either 1, 2, 2, 2, or 2, 1. Now, three ways in which the maximum is 2. Now, five ways in which the maximum is 3. You have to look at the picture. You have to look at the 36 outcomes. You say, when is it that the maximum is 3? To the whole way, right? The way that you are buying in the canvas. And this one happens. When you compute the sum of the values from the probabilities, and you get 4.5%. This is a bit tedious. It's just to confirm that you understand the vector space and the random variable of one. I keep on dangling on the same day. Okay, let X be a random variable. Meanwhile, show that D of 2 to 3 years, you get an A. And you see, okay, that the 2 plus 3x, the mean value of x is 1. So that's okay. I get 2 plus 3, I get 5 already. So then I get the mean value of 3x squared bigger than 3. So I have to show that the mean value of x squared is bigger than 1. So that's the question. My random variable is mean 1. Why is it that the mean value of x squared is at least 1? So I have to relate the mean value of x squared to the square of the mean value, which is 1. And there's a g. So the question is, I know that e of x is 1. I want to show that e of x squared is bigger than 1. That's the question. I could have said, OK. That takes me a random variable of 1, show that E of x squared is bigger than 1. The same question. But like these guys, they tell you not much. You know that the bias for random variable is non-negative. Right? This is a mean value of x minus its mean squared, so that's non-negative. But it's also E of x squared minus E of x squared. And therefore, the mean value of x is bigger than the mean value of x. So that's tricky. So this is tricky. This is a difficult question. This is the most difficult question. So you have a geometric random variable. And so this is the number of times it takes to flip a coin until I get the first heads. this is x. And I know that I have to flip it more than n times. So what do I know? I know that I flipped it n minus 1 times, and I got tails. And I'm asking, given that, okay, what is the number of times that, how many more times do I have to flip the coin? So I just flip n minus 1 times, and I got tails. Now I start flipping. What is the mean number of flips until the first time? How many times do you have to flip a coin until the first time? Not over. 1 over p. But I already flipped n times. So I flipped n times, I failed. Now I know that on average I need 1 over. It's n plus 1. This was a difficult one.
Why did n and not n plus 1?
Well, because I flipped n times, maybe n plus 1 would be successful. I failed n times, and now I start again. I start afresh. I failed n times, then I start flipping my phone until I get the first head. Another issue will take me 1 over p, but I already flipped 10 times. This was difficult. I agree, this was difficult. We roll without n times. Let's extend the average of the crystal all of the values of 10, the value goes for the sum. Okay, so some students complain that the wording is a bit complicated, confusing. So the TAs posted, I think, a note clarifying what this means. We have flipped the coin n times. Xn is the average number of pips. So it's the total number of pips of the n roll divided by n. That's what we mean by the average number of pips per roll. If you flip them, it's reasonable, right? You flip a coin, you roll a die 5 times, the average number of pips per roll is the number of pips divided by 5. We call it xn for n rolls. We want to compute the variance of xn. You may need the answer also. Let me show you the answer. So it's 1 over n times the variance of x1. Why? Because xn, so it's the sum of n terms, number of rolls of the pips on the first roll, second roll, n. Right? So it's the sum of n terms. The variance of the sum would be the sum of the variances, so it would be n times the variance of one roll, divided by n squared. Mm-hmm. Write this carefully. Okay, so xn is y1 yn over n, where the y's are the number of pips on the successive rows, right? y1 on the first row, y2 on the second row. By n of n, one, I divide by n, that's the average number of pips per roll. The variance of xn is the variance of y1 plus y, right? Divided by n squared. Because if you multiply a random variable by c, the variance is multiplied by c squared. But the variance of a sum of independent random variables is the sum of the variances. So I get n times the variance of x1 of y1 divided by n squared, which is the variance of y1 divided by n. What is y1? It's the number of pips in one roll, which is also, right, you could say it's x1. Because x1 is the average number of pips in one roll, so it's the number of pips in one roll. So that's 1 over n times the variance of one. What is the variance of this one? So it's the variance of the number of pips when you flip it, when you roll a die once. So it's the second moment minus the first moment squared. E of x1 squared minus E of x1 squared. Second moment minus first moment. The reason for you is 2.5. But if you do the math, which I do not ask you to do, you get 35 over 5. This y also goes to 0. Things have a data, you need to load that. This is something where you need to calculate. Okay, so x and y are independent, they are geometric. It's two different parameters. What is the property that x is less than y? There are many ways in which x can be less than y, right? X is the value, and y is a bigger value, and x is less than y. So what I will do is I will write the sum over all the possible outcomes where y is bigger than x. Say, well, I sum over the value of x, so x to be x, and then y is to be bigger than x. Right? That's all the ways in which y can be bigger than x. I have to write the pointer there. The pointer that y is, that x, is 1 minus px minus 1 times p, the metric. The pointer that y is bigger than x is 1 minus q to the x minus p. I think about flipping a coin, right, until you get less. You have to flip more than x times with the first x minus 1 times you got tails. So it's 1 minus 2 x minus 1, right, for y being bigger than x. Now we can rewrite this. We have p times the sum of those things. 1 minus p times y minus 2 to the x ranging from 0 to infinity. This is just a geometric series. So we have p over 1 minus 1 times p over 1 times 2. P over p. So that's a bit complicated. So not that complicated. Yes.
I'm confused on how why the x minus 1 between the x and minus 1.
Because I sum from 0 to infinity. So if you want, I replace x minus 1 by y. And then x was going from 1 to infinity, x minus 1. Yeah. See, you're summing, when you look at this sum, you're summing the exponent going from 0 to infinity. Geometric series, the sum of a to the n is 1 over 1 over 0. Well, the balance dies 5 times. X is the number of things to do. Okay. We draw a picture, it's a bit confusing. That's 5 times. 5 times. One, two, three, four, five. The sum here is y, the sum here is x. Well, we compute the mean value of x given that y is 4. Right, so I'm told that the sum of the last two is 4. I want to know what is the mean value of the sum of the 5 points. So I know already that these two give me 4. This doesn't tell me anything about the first three. So the mean value that I get on the first three will be the mean values. And on average, when you roll a die, the mean value that you get is 3.5. So I should get 4 plus 3 times 3.5. Something a bit interesting, you know, quite a few students, probably not you, wrote 4 plus 3 times 3.5. But then they came up with very creative answers for how much 3 times 3.5 is. And I saw anything from 7.5 all the way to 12.5 from 3 times 3.5. So it shows the effect of stress. So stress can debilitating, right? And that's, so it's clear that if on stress, you cannot multiply 3 by 2.5. It explains why there are many other questions like this that you cannot answer, right? You lose, we are aware of that, right? I'm teaching over here, I know that. I've seen oral exams where students cannot tell their name. I've seen oral exams where the students collapse, they pass out. There was so much stress. So I know that this explains a lot. So given that you say that 3 by 3.5 is 12.5, you can explain the other scores, right? Just stress. We should probably correlate on this together. Okay, let's look at the other one. If I know that the sum is 15, the mean value of the sum, but the sum is 15. The sum is 15, there are 5 rolls. So on average per roll, you must get 3. Because 5, right? So given that the sum is 15, that means that per roll you get 3. The 3 times, right? So the last two on average will give you 6. 3 plus 3. This is a cute problem. I like it. You probably do not appreciate it. You may not have the same sense of aesthetics, but I think this is very okay. How many times do you have to take the side? So this is difficult. Yep.
Can you explain the symmetry argument?
So you know that the sum is 15. There are 5 rolls. So on average, per roll, you get 3. You get 3 times 5, you get 15. So then you say for the last two, well, you should get 2 times 3. There's no reason to think that the last two will give you more than the average or less than the average. Okay. So here you have total condition on the outcome of the last one. So you have flipping a coin, third coin, right? And you want to know how long does it take until I get 2 consecutive heads. So you think mentally, okay, if I, as long as I flip tails, I'm not making progress. Right? Maybe I get a head. Oh, then I may be lucky the next time I get head. Right? But if I do not, then I start again. So that's why you should condition on the last outcome. There was a question. So then you start, right? Let A of S be the average type from the start until you get 2 consecutive S. That's what you have to find. Right? We start, we call A of S the average type, you have to check until you get 2 consecutive. Let A of H be the average number of touch, given that we just got S. If I just got S, it's default now, right? I have a chance to make a second. So let's call A of H. Given that I just got H, what is the average number of times that I still need to flip to get a second? Consecutive. A of T, the average time, given that I just got tails. So you count the condition of the last. If we start, then we roll once, and then maybe we'll get heads. It's 21 up, and then the average number of times will be A of H, is the way we define it. Yeah. Or I get tails, and then it's 21 up, then I get A of tails. A of tails, what is it? Well, it's 1, I roll once. With 21 up, I get tails, so then I start again, and I still need A of T. Or with 21 up, I get heads, and then I need A of X. Your friends, well, it's pretty, I roll once, it's 21 half, I get tails, and then I start again, I have A of T. And all with 21 half, I get the second, that's done. 0 more time. I'm done. You solve, and you get, your friends is 6. So you have to roll, you have to flip 6 times until you get 2 consecutive ones. So to understand this problem, you just think, you draw pictures, say I do tails, I'm not making progress. When I get half, oh, maybe I'm making. When I get tails, I'm back to square one. So that's the idea, right? Tricky. Do that, this is a good point. Here there was a typo. It was P initially. It was corrected hopefully in time during the exam. We got a long discussion in Piazza telling us that we have to be very careful to avoid typos. So we are probably not aware that we have to be careful to avoid typos, and we probably did this out of sheer neglect. That's one option, right? Another possibility is that, well, yes, the typo came in and happened. So we apologize for confusing it. We try to avoid this in the future, but we are sure that we will not be able to avoid it on the time. Right? But anyway, we take that point very seriously. This should be one of them. So we want to know the point is that the sample mean differs from the mean by more than A, and we want to use Chebyshev. So we tell you, don't try to use Markov, use Chebyshev. You get a lot of value. No, sir, well, this should be less than the variance divided by A squared. So we have to compute the variance of the sample mean. We have just done that before, right? The variance of x1 divided by n. The variance of x1 is y minus p over p squared. So we recall that the variance of x is 1 minus p over p squared. So what you have to remember is that the variance of the sample mean will be the variance of x1 divided by n. So that was, I think, also a gimme, right? To make up for the previous one, because I tried to balance things like that. Okay, last problem. This I like too. It's a cute problem. Okay, there are two envelopes. One that contains checks with values 1 and 0, and another with 4 checks, 4, 5, 5, 7. You choose one of the two envelopes random. You pick up one check at random, and it's for $5. And the question is, should I take this envelope or should I switch to the other envelope? Right? And if you look at this, okay, these are the two envelopes, you pick a sixth, it's intuitively clear that the sixth came from the second envelope. It's much more likely than the first one, right? Because you have two chances out of 4 to get to 5 if you have the second envelope, but you have only one chance out of 5 if you pick it from the first. So it's clear, but Bell's rule being so intuitive now in your mind, that given that you got a 5, it must be from the second envelope. But then you look at the two envelopes and you see, oh, there's a little bit more money in the first envelope than the second one. And since I'm very likely to have picked the second envelope, I should switch. If you don't know, I will switch with it. Yeah? So if you can do this like this, you understand it. So the answer is, if this intuitively, that the 5 you got is more likely to come from the second envelope. Since the first one contains more money, you should switch. Right? Now we can confirm. Let P be the property that you pick the first envelope. And then you use Bayes' rule. You pick the 1/2, you pick the first envelope, and then you change 1 out of 5, you get the 4. The $5 check. Right? Divided by the 20. Plus 1/2 times 2 out of 4. And you get 2 out of 7. So this is a property that you pick the first envelope, the property that you go the second one is 5 out of 7. Right? So given that you got the $5, you it's very likely that you got the second envelope, so you should search. Well, there's a little bit more with the first one. If you have better, it's $1 or more than you. It's 22 instead of 21.
So I mean, if it's just like, instead of being 22, like 21.1?
Yes.
Do we have to go through the calculations to find out whether we have to switch or not?
No. If there's a little bit more money in the first envelope, you should switch to the first envelope. Because you are afraid, the weight that you have picked the wrong envelope is bigger than 50%. So, if there was less money in the first envelope, then you should stick to the one that you need. I think it's a nice problem. This is Bayes' rule in action. Okay, some problems are very easy. right? Some problems were very difficult, and it explains why the average is low. And it explains why if you get average, you are doing okay. If you got significantly less than average, then maybe you should make sure that the little points that you do not understand, you will understand them before the final. Right? And then you will do well on the final, and life will be sweet, you have a happy application. And if you fail the final, or you fail the course, you'll be very sorry for the rest of your life. But nobody is that worse things at the minimum, right? So don't do anything crazy. But no, hopefully I hope that you will all correct the slight gaps in your understanding, if any. So that by the time of the final, you will ace it, you'll get 82 out of 100, or 95 out of 100. And some people did it on the return. So it was discouraging for me when I was a student. I would struggle to an exam, do okay, right? And then there would be somebody in the class with a 99. I said, what the heck? That was all the time. It was never me, it was somebody else. What's wrong with me? But that's okay, in the long term, you will correct your weaknesses, you will find. Also, one moral of the story is that the difficulties that you have should not spoil your enjoyment of the theory, of the material. Probability is a beautiful theory. So the fact that you struggle with it should not spoil your enjoyment. You say, that's okay. When you go over these difficulties, I'm good at probability, I just do probability. That's okay. I still enjoy probability. I love it. I think it's important in life. So it should not spoil your enjoyment. And there's nothing more sad to see students discouraged by difficulties in their test. And it's a shame, right? You all have the potential to become great probabilists. So you should be. Right? And I think it's a very important topic in computer science or in anything. Data science is a big thing. Right? And this is the foundation of data science. If you understand this, you'll understand data science. You'll understand statistics, you'll understand how to extract information from data. So this is very important. So please do not get discouraged. This is just to say, okay, there's a midterm correction here, we will do it with it. Any questions? Are you more puzzled now than you were when you came into the room? Or about the same? Or less?
Less.
Was this useful?
Yes, thank you.
Did you waste your time? Okay. I'm glad. So
okay, so the way we can do this, actually, since you have your laptop right here, you probably don't need a flash drive. I can probably just directly connect it. But yours is a Mac, right? Or is this a PC? It's a PC. Okay, then it's fine. Okay, so this is all done. I'm gonna